Thank you, Dr. Panda and Dr. Maheshwari. You have really successfully pulled off this meeting amidst the petering of Delta and the rising of Omicron. So it's hats off to that. I'm going to take you straight to managing hyperglycemia when stakes are high. The intricacies in inpatient hyperglycemia management. Center. Okay. So these are my financial disclosures. The agenda is going to be guidance for optimal management of hyperglycemia in non-critical care, benefits of the newer analogs, and my clinical experience. Let's look at the guidance for optimal management of hyperglycemia in non-critical care. Hyperglycemia and mortality in non-critical care. I think the graph speaks it all. Patients with normoglycemia, patients with known diabetes, and newly discovered hyperglycemia. So hyperglycemia is generally associated with an increased risk of mortality. And how are you going to manage this hyperglycemia in the hospital setting? And the therapy is divided into insulin, which is the recommended, and OADs, which are usually not recommended. You can have insulin, which is intravenous in the critically ill patients in ICU, and subcutaneous insulin in the non-critically ill patients. We all know that the sliding scale is slowly sliding out because it is non-physiological with retrospective reaction to blood glucose levels. Poorer glycemic control and increased risks of hypoglycemia. It promotes the glucose roller coaster and cannot predict insulin dosage requirements. It is not individualized, and it's a reactive approach practice. See and react. And you can see the roller coaster wonderfully drawn with the red graph. The basal bolus regimen has superior efficacy compared to the short-acting subcutaneous insulins. It's a physiological way of glycemic control, and ADA recommends the use of basal bolus regimen inpatient settings. It addresses three components. It addresses the fasting state insulin requirement, bolus, the mealtime insulin requirement, and correctional, this is important, unexpected glucose elevations or dispose of elevated hyperglycemia. Basal, bolus, and what is not known is the correctional phase. So implementing this basal bolus therapy to manage inpatient hyperglycemia in non-critically ill patients will improve glycemic control. There'll be fewer hyperglycemic and definitely hypoglycemic episodes. If you look at the dosing in the basal bolus in non-critical care, you calculate the total daily dose. Divide this equally between basal 50% and bolus 50% insulins. Bolus insulin is divided equally or depending on the meal, usually equally between the three major meals. And you measure blood glucose four times, three pre-meals and one at bedtime. You measure the insulin sensitivity. And based on the blood glucose measurement and insulin sensitivity, you add correctional insulin to the bolus dose. And based on fasting sugar, titrate the basal insulin. The total daily dose, of course, in ideal body weight is 0.4 to 0.5 units per kilo. In obese, it is 0.5 to 0.6. And in the lean and renally compromised, it's 0.3 to 0.4. This is the correctional insulin protocol, where depending on the sensitivity, either in the usual or in the insulin resistant, you have an add-on to the bolus. You have to go for the gaps. The gaps in treatment are extremely important. In the basal bolus regimen, in hospital requirements, ease of titration, effective glycemic control, lower risk of hypoglycemia, flexible and simple dosing, and usage in a wide range of populations. Now let's look at the benefits of newer analog insulins in inpatient care. I know Dr. Supratik and the others have given you a snapshot, but the real-world trials and real-world evidences have shown consistent efficacy and hypoglycemia benefits with degludec in outpatients with type 2 diabetes. And if you look at all the trials, begin, switch, devote, and conclude, which were random control trials, and real world, which is EU treat, confirm, and reflect, they measured A1C, FPG, doses, hypoglycemia, and had a comparator with them, glargine U100 in most of them. In conclude, they had glargine U300, and in confirm, they had glargine U300. And it was very clear here that the arrow of reduction was to the left when you used degludec. Let's see. The important metrics of basal insulins to be clarified in inpatient care. Degludec reaches a steady state in 2 to 3 days. Glargine 300 in 3 to 4 days. And glargine 100 in 2 to 4 days. The onset of action is within 0.5 to 1.5 hours with degludec. With glargine 300, goes up to 2 to 6. And glargine 100, 2 to 4. So the rapid onset of action with degludec, which attains steady state in a similar fashion compared to other basal insulin analogs, makes it very useful. The rapid attainment of glycemic control with insulin degludec in hospitalized patients, where you see that degludec was titrated daily in both medical and surgical hospitalized patients. The mean blood glucose level on day one was within the ADA recommended targets with degludec, 180, and if you see, there was no episode of severe hypoglycemia, no hypoglycemia of severe nature, and the mean blood glucose levels were about 185. See this paper by Simeoni et al., where there was lower hypoglycemia with degludec. Only one nocturnal hypoglycemic episode occurred in this study, where the efficacy and safety of degludec for hyperglycemia management in non-critically ill hospitalized patients was seen. 48% of the population, mind you, was more than 75. And CKD was seen in 35% and PVD in 23%. So this demonstrated efficacy with very low risk of hypoglycemia. The IDO study again confirmed the lower hypoglycemia with degludec. You see the subjects with percent of hypoglycemia when you see degludec and glargine in the no episode, in the diurnal episode, and in the nocturnal episode. And if you see in the pre-switch, see what happens where you get much better results with degludec. So again, demonstration of hypoglycemic efficacy, very low risk. What about glycemic variability? Today, insulin is looked at with glycemic variability, and control is looked at with glycemic variability, because you can have people with normal fasting post-lunch, but high A1Cs because of wide swings in GV. If you look at degludec, in the graph which is compared with glargine 100 and with glargine 300, you see the lower glycemic variability. Treating diabetes and insulins is a delicate path. You have to tread carefully. Just because you have potent, nice insulins with you, you can't keep shooting in the dark. So the choice of mealtime insulin is extremely important. Effective glycemic control with faster aspart. Faster aspart given 20 minutes post-meal provides similar A1C control versus insulin aspart given before meals. So aspart before meals and faster as per up to 20 minutes after meal. Similar A1C as you can see in the graph. There is lower risk of hypoglycemia with the faster aspart. And you can see overall, daytime and nocturnal, when you compare faster aspart in the deep blue and insulin aspart in the gray. So significant lower risk of overall and nocturnal with fast acting insulin aspart. What is the flexibility of faster aspart? More convenient in daily life, allows for more precise calculation of dose based on carbohydrate consumed, reduces the risk for hypoglycemia should a meal be delayed, particularly useful for elderly patients with cognitive impairment and or irregular eating habits, and also useful in those whose eating behavior is known to vary considerably. See the clock before start of a meal on the left and up to 20 minutes after the meal on the right. What is my clinical experience with the newer insulins and hospital hyperglycemia? This patient admitted for the management of an acute viral illness. These days, all illnesses are viral, remember that. Or everything else has gone under the carpet. 40-year-old male admitted with PUO, 3 months duration, known case of diabetes, past 8 years. Metformin, Sita, Telma, that's what he's on. He's well-built, 80 kilos, BMI 25 roughly. His random sugar on admission, 150, A1C 7.5. Now what happens? See, no insulin given. And when you start with the pre-meal, and especially when you're looking at how the scale is written there, -4, -2, same, +2. And what happens with faster aspart? With faster aspart, breakfast, lunch, and dinner. See what happens to the blood glucose reading. Day 1, day 2. And you can see how wonderfully, with proper titration, day 3 results are 130, 180, 150, 180. So the case continues on day 5, 24 hours blood glucose monitoring was done. This is another thing. Insulin is no longer FPG, PPG, and A1C. It is CGM, glycemic variability, amount of hypoglycemia, glucometers sooner than later. Everybody goes to Dubai for the Pfizer, but when he comes back, he has the CGM machine, which he says, abhi mujhe kiski zarurat nahi. He moves it over his shoulder and he says, see, my sugar is 180. So today CGMs are in vogue and they will stay. And on day 5, 24 hours, blood glucose value by glucometer, as you can read, all under 150. The summary was inpatient hyperglycemia and newer insulins. Basal bolus regimen is preferred to sliding scale. Degludec is effective, safe, and can be titrated daily. Evidence has shown that Degludec cohort maintained a mean blood glucose, which was within the ADA recommended targets of 140 to 180. And faster aspart is effective, safe, and offers post-meal flexibility. With these newer insulin, you have a winning edge. Maybe when we meet next year, when Omicron is behind us, and we'll have a larger meeting, probably no hybrid meeting, but a full virgin meeting of only physical. We'll probably have some other gimmick, another insulin, because every step that we take is for the benefit of our patients. Every diagnostic aid is for the benefit of the doctors and the patients. Thank you for your patience.